Welcome. We're going to get started. I'm Kyle DeQuian. I'm the executive director of the Poetry Project. It's so special and encouraging and meaningful to be gathered with you today to celebrate Lewis Warsh. Before we begin, I do want to just briefly share some quick practical information with you. There are two restrooms on the ground floor located on each side of the sanctuary in the back. Many of you are asking about book sales. We're thrilled to have copies of Lewis's book Elixir for sale in the Parish Hall, and those will be available starting at 7 during our reception, with thanks to Ugly Duckling Press for bringing those and for bringing this beautiful book into the world. We have a wonderful program today that should run until about 7 p.m. If at any point you want to take a break from the program, there's sparkling water available in the Parish Hall. You should feel free to move between this space and that space through the course of the memorial. And after our readings and performances, we will have a more organized reception with wine and sparkling water and some refreshments, including gluten-free refreshments, in the Parish Hall. We're eager to share this program with you. It's a tremendous, exciting breadth of folks who are participating. We're gonna roll right into each reader. If you need a cue, I will come back up to the mic and introduce you, but we hope that all of the readers will just come one after the next. This is the first time we've been gathered in this space for a memorial since January of 2020. And we are very honored that this return is to celebrate someone whose kindness, teaching, editing, friendship, attention, and poetry has so vastly shaped the work and the experience of community that has happened here. So thank you for being with us. Thank you to Lewis Warsh. And I'm gonna turn things now to Kat Lissard, Marie, Max, and Sophia Warsh.
Thanks, Kyle. I wrote this out so I wouldn't, you know. So we want to join in Kyle's welcome and also thank you all for being here. Marie, Sophia, Max, and I have been working on again, off again, on again, at putting this day together since November of 2020. As all of you know, Lewis was not a great fan of technology. He liked to boast that he'd never sent a text message. And as the pandemic was taking hold, he was pretty clear that the virtual world wasn't for him. Zoom, he'd say, what is Zoom? He very much wanted there to be a gathering of friends, family, colleagues, and students. And he asked us to promise to wait until it was possible to have that gathering in person here in this space, which was so much a part of his life. We were fortunate that Kyle was also committed to that promise and to waiting until that promise could be fulfilled and to the on again possibility of this day, no matter when it might be. We're grateful for everything he and the Poetry Project staff have done to make it happen. We're also grateful to all the tribute givers, poetry readers, and performers who have also been waiting, and to all of you here today. Thank you for waiting with us, and thanks again for being here.
Dad, you are this cloud I'm looking at above the San Francisco Bay. A bedtime routine involving Dad as a hyperactive wolf and a trick where he launched a rubber band from his hair. Summers at Whispering Pines, Mom and Dad made whole wheat bread, Dad's energetic butterfly stroke. Friday night dinners at the Odessa, Brooklyn beach trips with warm orangina and cheese sandwiches, everything a little caked in sand. Dad would pick us up from PS19. It was when he started dressing less hippie. He had short hair, a white button-down shirt, and the shoulder bag. The familiar yet exciting walk home down First Avenue. Learning to play catch and softball, Dad loved watching Marie and Max playing team sports. Dad would drive me and Wang Ping in one of his infamous cars to Chinatown. We would double park, and she and I would go to all the markets. Passover in Chelsea at Grandma and Grandpa's house, we loved playing hide the matzah with our cousins. Dad's famous school lunches, Munster cheese sandwich with lettuce on a soft roll, a stack of Entenmann's chocolate chip cookies wrapped in copious amounts of tinfoil, and a Capri Sun. He would buy all these fashion magazines to make collages, and I would be reading a Cosmo and suddenly there would be a big hole in it. Hot summer nights in Park Slope, eating fruit salad and cottage cheese for dinner on the back porch. The classic Dad afternoon, a museum, lunch, and a trip to the art supply store. In particular, I remember us discovering V.S. Elman's in the 90s. In college, Dad and I talked about jazz and dance. He loved my friend Elizabeth Ward, who is still a dancer. For about a year, I worked at the Writing Center at LAU and made friends with Valerie Deyes and Courtney Frederick. It was a glimpse into Dad's work life that I relished. The 60th birthday party that Kat planned for Dad, where he got toasted and a little roasted. Hanging out with Dad when Kat was out of town, he missed her and we would eat comfort foods. Dad came to visit me in St. Louis and we talked for so long that my mouth hurt and we both needed to lie down. Dad eagerly listened to all the details of my life as a graduate student in Boulder. And he would tell me about going there as a teenager, going to some of his first poetry readings. He claimed that the streets of downtown Boulder were made of dirt and that he got mugged there. On his visits for Naropa, we drove around in the heat, attending readings together and eating out, and he loved searching for presents for Kat. When I moved to the Bay Area, Dad was thrilled. He told me about hitchhiking to Mendocino to camp on the beach alongside real-life hobos. The next morning, he immediately would buy a New York Times, a bar of chocolate, and a carton of milk. We had a lot of discussions as he was editing his part of Piece of Cake, and between us called it the Cupcake Book. Dad and I loved to discuss the antics and amazing qualities of his granddaughters, Zola and Vera. I miss walking the streets with Dad, chatting and commenting about everything under the sun, the spatial and temporal rhythms of the city unfolding around us. Now I imagine Dad when I go to Agate Beach in Bolinas, an almost hidden spot where he once lived. It turns out to be an important marine protected area with great opportunities for tide pooling. Dad said he wanted to live until my birthday, and that was the last time I saw him. He said, "I love you forever." Thanks, everybody.
Hi. Thank you, Kat and family and Kyle and the Poetry Project for including me and honoring Lewis today. I will be reading excerpts from The Flame Keeper, an essay on Lewis that I wrote for the Poetry Foundation. I first met Lewis upstairs in the office of the Poetry Project in 1994, where I just started working after finishing my MFA at the Naropa Institute, now university. He said that he heard I was a prose writer, not a poet. Was I a kindred spirit? Was I a novelist in disguise? Looking at a program for our Bernadette Mayer celebration, May 6, 2015. I'm reminded that I read right before Lewis. We often read at events related to Bernadette's work, and I saw him many times at gatherings at her house in upstate New York. We gossiped after readings, but I won't spill the beans. As the director of the MFA program in creative writing at Long Island University, Brooklyn, Lewis forged lines that connected the Poetry Project community to a new generation of experimental poets. I've read frequently in his Writers on Writing series, where I was welcomed by his students and enjoyed wine and food in a comfortable room that seemed to float over downtown Brooklyn. Lewis always seemed bemused by human comedy, and as many of his former students have pointed out, he really listened to you. I wasn't his student, although I think of him as a mentor. He taught by example, by his dedication to making, distributing, and publishing within a community organized around poetry. Along with his own poetry and fiction, I think of all the books Lewis helped to manifest in the world. Lewis believed in letting books live in the minds of readers, even if it meant giving many away for free, or nearly for free. I remember buying two copies of Hannah Wiener's The Fast for $5 each. With Ann Waldman, he co-founded Angel Hair Books in 1966 and published some of my favorite second-generation New York School classics like Joe Brainard's I Remember, Bob Rosenthal's Cleaning Up New York, Bernadette's The Golden Book of Words, and his own, The Maharaji's Son. I remember many United Artists book parties in the 90s and the early 2000s for Lewis's longtime students and friends like Bill Kushner and Daniel Krakauer. Lewis advocated keeping an archive of letters, cover art, and manuscripts as a backup retirement plan. He knew that being a poet is always a precarious position. Watching Lewis, I witnessed steadiness and discipline, a commitment to poetry and to living within an artistic community with its tangled and complicated personal histories and backstories. Lewis and Bernadette, Anne and Lewis, Ted and Alice, Alan and Peter, and others. Despite fractures, this community endured by virtue of its formative members, chief among them, Lewis, who did the work of curating, fundraising, publishing, and teaching by example. His enduring curiosity and openness to young poets and students helped hold open the entrance to this community, and his love, commitment, and gentleness tended the flame that still burns after 55 years.
One day in the early 70s, I went to the mailbox, and out of the box came a long poem on mimeograph paper, which was the way things were reproduced then, if you could do it yourself. And it went on and on and on. It was extraordinary. And I thought, what on earth? Who wrote this crazy poem about the ocean? It was called This Great and Wide Sea. And check it out, it's very much around still. In it was essentially a collage book in which he had torn up a book about the sea and used little snaps of it in this setup. Way that you couldn't get any special readings out of it or anything. It wasn't clearly meant to be that. And I looked at it and I thought, you know, this is really fantastic. I'm going to write to this Lewis Warsh man and find out who he is. And so I did, and so I met him down here at the Poetry Project. It was a meeting place. And I was enormously pleased. Well, after many years of working at different projects and so on, Lewis said to me, why don't you keep a journal of making a particular painting so we can all see what goes through your head? And I did. And I kept a journal and produced in one summer, starting in August about, and ending in November, I produced four paintings all along this razor wire fence that was very remarkable stuff and had just been introduced. It was suddenly took over the town. You could see there's no getting through this stuff. And that was a major project of my life, and those four paintings were quite a nice set, I think. I like them anyway a lot. Lewis was, I would say, very ambitious with his work. He drove himself to work enormously day and night. And yet he was sort of modest in another way. And that interested me a lot. I found that was very attractive. A very attractive, some sort of weird contradiction of ambition and lack thereof. It was a very interesting situation with him. Now I want to turn over to Pamela.
This place, the St. Mark's Poetry Project community, and all of you, came to me through my relationship with Elio Schneeman. I met many of you at Elio's Along the Rails book party in 1991 in his parents, George and Katie Schneeman's living room at 29 St. Mark's Place. At the time, I was amazed by the warmth of the crowd, how effervescent and connected you all seemed to me. I was on the outside and felt apart. Lewis was a bridge. With his long, ring-adorned fingers gesturing like an El Greco figure or a Yoshiko Chuma dance, he entered my studio uninvited during a dinner Elio and I gave him in honor of the upcoming Along the Rails being published by Lewis and United Artists Books. My studio doors were closed. I had panicked before his arrival. I'd met him briefly, and I wasn't ready, I had decided, to expose myself to his scrutiny. I had read A Free Man, after all, and was suitably in awe. His description of a man narrating washing dishes had transformed this dreary task into an ongoing aesthetic experience for me. He nevertheless beguilingly insisted and, rifling through my work, found a painting for the cover of Along the Rails. And just like that, we became friends and collaborators. Our subsequent collaborations on the books Private Agenda, A Place in the Sun, and numerous book and the world covers were born from this moment in my studio where trust replaced fear. While teaching at the Bronx Museum, I organized a poetry reading featuring Lewis, Elio, and Wang Ping. Greeting Lewis in the elevator with his entourage, including Rudy Burkhart, as we rode up, a man introduced himself as Rackstraw. Rackstraw Downs, I said, again in awe. Our conversation led to the challenges of painting outside, and as a result of a subsequent studio visit, I invested in a better plein air easel and silk long underwear from L.L. Bean at his recommendation. Thus, our connections wove between friendship and creative inspiration. We three began meeting many Sunday evenings at Suen, starting in 2006 and continuing until 2019, our last in-person visit taking place at Rackstraw's loft. When Lewis couldn't come anymore, my now husband, Danny Lietzel, and I continued, to join Rackstraw for Sunday dinners. Naturally, we began drawing one another, a practice within widening circles of friendship and creative impetus that we continue today. Thank you, Lewis, and thank you all.
Ashe for Lewis, Warsh, Ashe. I'm Erica Hunt, and this is Lum Lai. And I am splitting my 4 minutes with Lum. First, a poem. Lewis Warsh possessed the gift of talk, as if picking up in the middle, where it began days ago, before you fell asleep. Consciousness hardly losing a beat and waking again to catch the measure. Never really lost reveals a ratio between artful, a heartful, mixes into everyday speech, registered as the humanly possible kindness. Among the things Lewis left us is this: friendship, poems, the type that connects threads in which you meet someone who knew him, and so on. Repeated loops every day. Lewis was a ubiquitous presence in silhouette throughout my early poethood, and although I was born in New York, my poetry was incubated in San Francisco, and even then I knew him as a legendary prolific poet and co-editor of United Artists, a late phase of the Mimeo Revolution, the New York School, and everything cool. But first, I also knew him as the first organizer of the reading series at Intersections in San Francisco. When I arrived in 1976, was my first poetry classroom. Later, when I returned to New York, I got to know Lewis better through the project, and the tracks deepened when Lewis, along with John, hired me to teach at LIU. And then I saw him most days when he was in the office with collegiality, and then conspiring, breathing together as we strived to save the program that had grown there. Lewis was very easy to talk to, and he loved to gossip, as you all know, and laugh and drop into reverie as quick as a cloud covering the sun, light to shade, and shade to light in the next moment. Heartbreak, human, a silly joke, the capacity to be joyfully shocked or inscrutable and dry. From that short time, teaching in the same program with Lewis, I understood something else about him. The ways we talk about lineage is too limited and patriarchal. But when we pay attention, we see the ways that poets influence each other, even before we meet. Another way of understanding the matrix of influence is to study different forms of symbiosis. For instance, forest ecology, how tree roots absorb information as well as nutrients from the mycorrhizal fungi, mushrooms that feed on soil and tree. And those whispers travel along a root system of call and response, and information and nurturance, and collective survival. And that, I think, is how Lewis taught me and has taught other poets, feeding us poets with nurturance and voice and dream and speculation and the everyday miraculous. In that spirit, I brought Lum Lai here because Lum Lai was one of Lewis's last students at LIU in the MFA program, and is the founder of the Lewis Warsh Poetry Society among the LIU alumni. And it's also important to know that Lum was a student of Wang Ping, who was a student of Lewis's. So that poetic momentum, the poetry that he brought into the world, continues. And with that, I want to thank the organizers of this gathering, because it brings Lewis into the room with people who loved him. Mom.
So I didn't know that you knew him all the way back in San Francisco. Yeah, we need to talk about that more. But I'm not surprised, because he's just everywhere. So I am a student of Erica and Wang Ping, who you know is also a student of Lewis. And then in turn, I also became a student of Lewis. He inspired me to live a very cluttered lifestyle, which came in very useful this morning when I found these three things that I got from him. During one of the office hours that I had with him, I saw this book lying on the table, and I don't know what came over me, but I just asked him point blank if I can have this book. And he gave it to me without any hesitation. And here is the syllabus from one of my classes with him. English 523, Graduate Fiction Workshop, Spring 2018, Lewis Warsh, Room 216. And as usual, it's only 2 pages long. But what's funny is that we didn't even end up doing most of the things on the syllabus. Okay, I know you know. What we often ended up doing was, Lewis would say, let's put off discussing this book and that book, and let's look at your writing. And then we would sit and write and talk. And we also did this. This is a picture of Lewis pouring wine for the rest of the class. We did this more often than we should admit. And Lewis just pours for everyone. He will let you know without telling you that this glass is yours, this room is yours, this poem is yours, and he too, and you too are yours.
Hello. I'm going to read a few short poems, three, in fact, from this book called Dreaming as One by Lewis Warsh, published by Corinth Books in 1971 and dedicated to Anne Waldman with a beautiful cover by Joe Brainard. And I carried this book around with me for a year or so when I was about 15 or 16. And it was, you know, so it was kind of like a talisman object in itself. But I realize now I was kind of looking for a kind of poetry that was going somewhere after New American Poetry, after the first generation New York School and the Beats and Black Mountain, which all of which I loved. And I was finding it in this book and in the work of some of Lewis's colleagues, Anne and Ron Padgett and Michael Brownstein come to mind in particular. And what I was finding in it and what I love about this book is there's this real feeling of a lived life and details from that life mixed with abstraction. Flashing. Love the cracks on the walls of your apartment and the electric light. The current of electricity passed through the hand on the switch. Love the hand. Like a bolt of lightning on a June night, a thunder shower. Stand under the porch roof and watch the downpour. Walk to the room you sleep in and lie down. Take off your shoes, listen to the radio, play records, read the newspaper, and rub your eyes, tired of reading the small lines of print stored inside your head. Let them out, as if you were leaping from a plane. Heaven, lighting up the apartment like a star. New Year's Eve for Ted. A year ago today, something happening inside. 3 inches of snow cover New York streets. Prediction. Heavy heart. Quiet mind. Larry and Joan taking a cab across town for dinner on the town. Then a party with friends. Something suspenseful, exciting, in the webbing, caught in my brain as I listened to this music, lit this cigarette, walked across the room to answer the phone. Wrong number. My timing's been off these last 6 months, but I've been on. Off and on is part of life's routine, breaking down into a pattern across the land. Country weather and wet spotted plants flowering on a windowsill, alive, well, and growing. For a moment, why doesn't the moment extend itself? I mean, the moment does, but you, changing through it, a different person walks through the mirror. Inside you, what is happening? The day is beginning. You are yourself, the parts of you everyone's seeing. You are everyone you've ever been with for a moment.
I'm going to read an excerpt from the poem titled, For 10 Years. It's after 3. I'm rushing up First Avenue late for the kids. The teacher won't let the kids leave the school unless there's someone to pick them up. The tall teacher waves to me. She looks like my sister who teaches school in the Bronx. There's the school. It's 3 o'clock, I'm waiting for the kids. There's Ted and Steve walking by. I'm leaning against a car. They say I look thin because I'm having too much sex. They make me blush in the sun as I lean back into the light, and we stand on the curb laughing. We stand outside the school, smoking in the sun. The trees in the park are old. Their branches touch the ground. The trees are outlined against the buildings. The branches of the trees make shadows against the sides of the buildings. I need some water or I'm going to fall down and die. I need some nourishment. 10 years is a long time. The people in the stores wave at me, so I walk down as I walk down First Avenue. The woman in the bakery gives cookies to the kids. It's almost summer, let's go to the park. We can go to the park after school now that it's getting warmer. You can shift your weight nervously from one foot to another. You can stand in a corner with a drink in your hand and think about the past. The clouds above the rooftops heading down to the river, the boats on the river and the factories on the other side. For 10 years, walking home as if nothing happened. Fill in the blanks, children, trees, shadows, clouds. There are the trees first, and then the shadows of the branches on the sidewalk. There's the school and a radio playing like a virgin. Someone in the park has a radio. Someone else is reading the newspaper. There are the trees leading down to the river and the empty park, the old people on benches, the women with strollers. There's the ghost of my heart waiting for the kids outside the school. My shadow on the bench, a child on the swings, as if 10 years nothing happened, thinking about sex like a shadow, while the people in airplanes passed overhead, while a cloud passed in front of the sun and the shadows spread over the pavement, as if for 10 years, stopping and starting, one cloud after another, going nowhere on the way home, coming back and starting again. Pictures of bodies on a bed, lengthening shadows, as if 10 years, walking up First Avenue to the school and then waiting, buying food, and on warm days going to the park. There's the bench where I used to sit, reading the newspaper and smoking.
Hello, everyone. On November 15th, 2020, Tony Iantosca, Lisa Rogal, and myself had a book party on Zoom, and Lewis had been in hospice, but we were hoping he'd be able to listen to us, so we dedicated the reading to him. He died later that afternoon. But this is a poem that I read that day. Okay. It was written in 19, as Vincent said, this book was published in 1971, so this was written when he was very young. What I learned this year: typing doesn't disturb anyone. Voices, beautiful voices, singing songs, don't disturb anyone. Footsteps on a thin wood floor. Don't disturb anyone. Don't disturb me. Please don't disturb me. Don't disturb anyone. This is what I learned this year. Golden voices sing beautiful songs. In your ear, shaky. I learned what shaky means this year, but don't ask me. I learned that there are no gurus this year, but I think I always knew that. Learned what Scorpio means this year, but don't believe it. I've learned to believe in chronology. It's so supporting. I learned that everyone can take care of themselves this year. I learned a lot about silence, friendship, love, and flowers. I learned something about destiny this year, but I've forgotten it already. Home. Did I learn anything about home this year? I learned that when your heart said yes, you did it. And that when your body said no, you stopped. I learned that only love can break your heart, but that your body can go on forever, so to speak. I learned a little about energy and distance. I think I understand what clairvoyance means. I learned that people spoke metaphorically when they didn't want to hurt you, and how kind they were. I learned how people's lives connect and what separate means, and the meaning of the word useful. I saw myself turning into my father, and I learned a lot from that. I learned that other people's thoughts couldn't affect you, and that it was a waste to think negatively about anything. I learned a little bit about ethics this year. I thought about Charles Olson and Frank O'Hara a lot this year. I learned that I was hooked this year, but I'm not sure to what. I learned what being self-involved means. I learned how to ride the music all over again. This year, I borrowed the lives of my brothers. I saw where my demons came from. I learned to dig the blank spaces. I saw where not having money could be limiting in the most boring way. I looked at peace as more than a blurred possibility, as in peace on earth or peace of mind. I learned that freedom's just another word. I learned that there was some other way. I learned what learning to forget meant, but realized I secretly remembered everything. I learned that unless you stop, it just goes on forever. that unless you stop it, just goes on forever, just goes on forever. I learned that no one disturbs anyone, i.e. it's all in your head, beautiful golden voices singing in your head. I learned what those lights blinking in the distance mean, what the branch brushing against the window means, what the writing on the wall meant, if you took it seriously, and the sense of inventory. I learned what it was like to feel fresh, almost virginal, unembarrassed by it all, and younger even than I was. 7/19/1971. Thank you.
Very honored to be here. I'm going to read from one of my favorite books. It's called A Place in the Sun. It was kind of hard to pick what I was going to read, so I kind of closed my eyes and picked something. So hold on to your hats. The first thing he saw when he entered the apartment was the girl tied to the chair. There were five cops in uniform in the hallway behind him. Each of them had a gun and was pointing it into the entrance of the apartment. It was what they had learned during the grueling months of apprenticeship at the police academy, the proper procedure for entering an apartment where a killer was hiding. The young woman in the chair had a strip of masking tape over her mouth. She wore a pale blue nightgown with tiny flowers embroidered along the sleeves. There was a white bow hanging down the front of the nightgown, but her shoulders and neck were bare. The light from the kitchen window behind her dovetailed across her back. It was like an aura, as if she were having a religious experience. There was a cloud of dust in the air around her head, and her hair billowed over her shoulders and arms. Her hair was red and curly and very thick. There were droplets of sweat and tears on her high cheekbones. She was crying, but she couldn't wipe away her tears. They just welled up in the corner of her eyes and spilled out. Her nipples were erect against the fabric of the nightgown, as if someone had been kissing them, as if the danger was making her excited. It was her hair he noticed first, the reddish tint that seemed to hold the light coming in from the window, then the terror in her eyes, the way she suddenly tilted her head toward the door of the bedroom as if to say, "He's there. The man you're looking for is in the bedroom with my friend." Of course, when he kicked open the bedroom door, he hadn't expected to find Irene, didn't know the woman's name or her relationship to the woman in the chair. He didn't know what to expect, really. The best equalizer in unpredictable situations is a weapon in your hand. Anything can happen when you confront a murderer in an enclosed setting. There's no way to predict what the person in the apartment will do. Harry Cray stood in front of the door and said Eddie's name to himself. Then he said it out loud. He said, "Put your gun down, Eddie, we're coming in." The five cops crouched behind him like lemurs, holding their guns with both hands. Harry thought for a split second of his daughter, Veronica, 17 years old, a freshman in college. The girl in the chair was probably older than his daughter. There was no similarity between them, really, except that they both reminded Harry of something he couldn't have, something he wanted that was always out of reach. There it was, like a brass ring, just beyond his grasp. There it was, a gift, an offering. But when he blinked, it disappeared. "It's over, Eddie," he said. He couldn't believe the guy thought he could escape. All the cops were in the room now, and there was the woman, obviously dead, whom he was supporting with one arm while he pressed the gun against the side of her face. The last thing Harry wanted to do was kill Eddie Perez, but the guy was giving him no choice. It was just a matter of time, though. It was Eddie's decision whether he wanted to spend the rest of his life in jail or die in the moment. The woman whom he was holding up as a hostage was naked. Her arms hung at her sides like a broken doll. Her head lolled back against Eddie's shoulder as if it was unhinged. There was blood on the bedsheets. Harry wanted to return to the kitchen and untie the woman in the chair. He felt like he was on a treadmill going backward, that there was no beginning or end, that he was on the edge of an invisible precipice, and that if he wasn't careful, he would slip off into the dark. He wished that someone else had the wherewithal to pull the trigger. He had had this feeling before, that he was drifting out of his body, floating like a ghost in the corner of the ceiling. He pointed the gun at Eddie Perez. One of the cops behind him shouted, "Do it! Do it!" as if he couldn't understand why Harry Cray was waiting or what he was waiting for.
Hi. I'm glad that we can all get together to celebrate Lewis, either in person or, in my case, virtually, because if anybody deserved being celebrated, it's certainly Lewis Warsh. I met Lewis, I think it was in 1967, and shortly thereafter, I and a group of friends, including Lewis, because Lewis had become a friend immediately, found ourselves at George and Katie Schneeman's apartment, where George and Katie's little boys had just acquired a new toy, a large metal robot, came in a box, and the robot was called Big Lou. And so we started calling Lewis Big Lou, which was kind of a joke, of course. So this would have been around 1968, I think. But it turns out that it applied to Lewis because he had a big intelligence. He was a very smart guy, and he certainly had a big talent, both as a poet and a fiction writer. I really envied his skill. He seemed to have such facility. The words seemed to trickle down out of his fingers onto the keyboard so easily. anyway, I really admired him and was envious of him, to tell you the truth, and inspired by him. So he had a big talent, but he also had a big influence on people, both as a publisher. He very selflessly lent himself to these small presses that he helped create and maintain and edit. Published a lot of people. He also had a big influence on his many students over at Long Island University. I visited his class once, and boy, those kids loved him. And also, Lewis had a big heart. By that I mean he was a very gentle soul, and it's something that one treasures more and more these days, especially. But throughout, I never felt an unkind moment from Lewis, or an unkind word, or I don't know, he was just a very sweet person, and I really liked him a lot. Now, the last time I saw Lewis, I was sitting in the Neptune restaurant on First Avenue, gazing out the window, and kind of half dazed, and Lewis went by. And it was kind of like he had a very majestic glide to his walk as he went by. He was like a great ocean liner going by. And I just sat there kind of transfixed by his sort of majesty. It was an odd moment, but a true one. Anyway, here's to Lewis. I miss him. I'm going to always miss him. And I wish his family and his other friends well.
Two poems by Lewis Warsh. For Ted, a tree struck by lightning will never be the same. Branches and leaves never heard from again. I'll ride my little boat to the center of the lake and build a moat out of mud and sand. The berries I picked last year will grow again. I'll pick the same thorns from my hand. I'm on the mend. but things are better. Wish you were here. Much love, your friend. Brooklynese, one would engage you in conversation if they knew your destination. A girl from a parochial school, if I may digress, our home and all the trees were made forever, but you ran off in your short plaid dress, a paradigm in the annals of consistency and pleasure. Your voice would spiral over bricks and stones, and you might sit back at your leisure, speak to me in dulcet tones, blowing like heather over your bones, bare knees showing as you climb the steps.
I'm going to read an excerpt from an obit I was asked to write a year ago for PN Review in the UK. Page 14, on first visit to MoMA in 58, I focused on Picasso's three musicians because I thought it the local Mona Lisa, size-wise, versus CinemaScope Guernica. I'd read in Life magazine that behind the musicians were Picasso's poet friends, Apollinaire, Jacob, and Reverdy. So in early 70s, when Louis, Anne, and Ron were sitting by me in the Orchidia at a post-reading event, I see Louis as Picasso's Reverdy. Even the current Wikipedia article on Reverdy captures Louis unwittingly. Reverdy remained independent of the prevailing isms, searching for something beyond their definitions. His writing matured into a mystical mission, seeking, as he wrote, the sublime simplicity of reality. The sublime simplicity of reality applies to Lewis's lifelong work. In even his most grammatically complex collagist poems, he speaks parentally to his reader. Then there's this, paralleling Louis and Anne's relationship. One of Reverdy's most enduring and profound relationships was with the couturier Coco Chanel. The intense period of their romantic liaison lasted from 1921 to 1926. Yet after the fire of this initial involvement cooled, they still maintained a deep bond and great friendship, which would continue for some 40 years. Unlike most, Louis held on to his youthful bonds religiously. He never let me forget our connection, corresponding regularly, even though I'd lagged behind. It wasn't sentiment. It was a loyalty to undestroyable history rather than the frontal reality of time passing. You could say his lifelong work was a more friendly parallel to Louise Gluck's. For many of us, it was Lewis who secretly won her Nobel Prize of a couple years ago. I feel nervous writing this, as if Lewis is saying, no, nothing mystical like Reverdy. The invisible world animated the historical context of even the Christian pews of St. Mark's Church back in the day. No one but Lewis saw its ancient origins and opened the Book of Common Prayer when I read my versions of the Psalms and reminded the audience they were contained in the book rack in front of them. Cat called when Lewis lost control of his hands in his last days, putting him on the line, his voice as strong as ever and worried, the most worried, inquiring voice I've known besides my mother's. Not about us per se, but about our ability to nail down a moment in history. Of course, nothing was nailed down except Lewis's voice in my ear, and in the communal ear, love poems by Frank O'Hara. It's never far off. Take me down, it says from the shelf. Take me down. Take me down, down, and open me, and open me. 1972. It was more strangely domesticated than Frank O'Hara's informal, though brilliantly timed, verse, Our New York School Master.
A dream, what can it mean? And that I was a maiden queen, guarded by an angel mild. Witless woe was ne'er
Lewis and I didn't meet in 1965 at the gatherings of CCNY's art literary magazine, Promethean, where my friend Ross Feld's precocious cohort included Robert David Cohn and Joel Sloman as students. But we could have met. I heard Lewis's name mentioned admiringly a lot. Years later, we found friendship. Lewis Warsh was a caring and generous person. He was blazingly brilliant. Hard to detect, smothered in that sweet persona, we danced around the idea of doing something together, and in 2017 collaborated on a large graphic poem called, or he titled, Single Occupancy. It is a comic book of one-liners congealed to a rock, and it is now being published by Cuneiform Press. Thank you, Kyle Schlesinger. Lewis was the only author I've ever known, be it in his poems or his prose, whose every sentence is a screenplay. Some lines from Single Occupancy. The apartment comes with a hot plate and a tub. The person I was kissing had changed her name. Some of his lines read like Aesop's warnings, but the silliness, naked and contextless, pulls a surprised, wizened sobriety to its side. Better run for cover before it gets too late. If you go to the well once too often, you fall in. Lewis scrutinized social behavior, logic, and language. He offered his findings without judgment, leaving us to face which of our biases flavored our conclusions about a line's intent. Distant cousins eating couscous on the grass behind the house. A movie of animals in a state of heat. Free of sentiment, but somehow marinated in memory, emotion, and candor. It's hard to tell if you're martini dry or licking a syrup. Lewis's intellect resided on that tightrope. The wolf at the door begins to bark when I say your name. It was all in your mind from start to finish. The oddities of Lewis's language enabled him to identify with a child's puzzlement at the codes of the mature world. His announcers display an ignorance of accepted rules, but still he doesn't forfeit an intimacy with the protagonists. The usherettes line up to use the payphones in the lobby. The planes are stranded on the runway, and the ice is melting on the wing. Dynamics shift between grown-up and kid, the controller and the controlled, proclamation and self-doubt. Lewis's speech tastes like adult responsibility, resisting intimidation from cross-examination. Perplexed, hard evidence is dismissed immediately as presented. Invited memory activates and spontaneously evaporates. There's a diner around the bend where you can get coffee to go and a slice of pie. They came out of nowhere and disappeared into the night. Asymmetric power riffled between experience and wonder as to what would happen if we, innocent, didn't know the outcome. It may all seem so snide, a wryness, but sarcasm is banished by Lewis as being too easy, leaving us to ask whether we are dealing with a puerile vaudevillian, a knucklehead, or facing the horrifying black hole of grace and surrender that questions purpose and ponders death. Now shaken, it occurs that a mysticism may in fact be waiting in the wings. You can park in front of a hydrant and no one will write you a ticket. A date in the future when you must vacate the premises. She lived on the same street all her life, I kid you not. For a millisecond, we think all of this is funny. An odor of humor hums, obstinate as gravity. Humor encrusts and then metastasizes each crumbling line. Each line avoiding anything as definite as demise, but always hinting at both that possibility and survival. While no redeeming direction is suggested for either outcome, anticipation without climax falls off a cliff. Slip into something cool and join me on the patio. Give credit where it's due or claim it as your own. This is the room where I lost my virginity. We're not sure as to whether something is a joke or reeking with tragic banality. a cop in uniform shopping for sheets at Target. Look at me for a moment when you have a moment. Helpless, we re-enter, read again, again. No platform juts underfoot. Lewis gives us our compass and then, as a kindly teacher but yet aloof, says, good luck. Both schooled and grateful, we read Lewis for that drip IV of nourishment. He gives us the ball. It is always in our court. You can spread your blanket on the sand and toss a beach ball into the air. Lewis inhabits courtesy. The costume gets our attention. Nothing is thrown at us. Lewis slips it under the door, radiant. You have to wait online for a drink at intermission. It's possible to fall in love with everyone you meet, at least for a minute. With love and respects to Cat Lessard, goodbye, dear friend Lewis. Your genius burnishes to a glow. Audrey Hepburn crawls across the kitchen floor with a knife in her teeth.
Hi. Thank you for the invitation. It's really great. I feel so honored to be among all of the speakers and the audience. Lewis and I collaborated on a book together in 2001 called Debtor's Prison, published by Steve Clay and Granary Books. We had never worked together, and I barely knew him, really. Steve put us together, thought we'd be a good match. We were both trying out new waters, or at least I was, and his words reflected that. He said he had never written in this way, either before or after, and he responded to photographs I had digitally grabbed from black and white, old black and white, reel-to-reel video I had shot in the 1970s. It was kind of a call and response that we did with each other. For example, beside a photograph of me sitting in a bathtub, breathing through a plastic tube underwater, he wrote, I hid my head in the muddy ground, but no one noticed. Redwood bar stool, bouffant hairdo. And beside a profile of an old lady who was my grandmother in her 90s, he wrote, I was thinking of you in a different context. I said your name in my sleep. No questions asked, no questions asked. Lewis later wrote about Debtor's Prison for Poetry Northwest in spring 2013. He wrote, juxtaposition creates its own sense of connectedness. Description, in this case, would feel redundant. It's always more interesting to pick up clues and hints along the way, to grope around in the dark, rather than to achieve some kind of conclusiveness. Something mysterious is conveyed, and possibly a third element, like the third term, is necessary to synthesize everything. Is necessary to synthesize everything. End of his writing. So to me, this is a good description of art, this third term, and a good description of Lewis. I'm still trying to synthesize what I experienced with him. This event today is helping me to accomplish this. Thank you.
Working with Lewis Warsh was always an effortless pleasure, indistinguishable from our friendship. We first met in Park Slope, a chance encounter on the street introduced by Mitch Highfill, where we briefly spoke about his collection of poetry books, literary relics, and archives. We arranged to meet again. Lewis's guilelessness, his friendliness, his generosity of spirit, his calm acceptance, humor, and humility opened a subtle creative space, call it sympathetic magic, within which we periodically worked for nearly 30 years. Lewis had inherent archival tendencies. In our first book project, Buston's Island 68, comprised black and white photos taken at Buston's Island in Maine and Bolinas. The photos of Lewis and Waldman, Ted Sandy and Kate Berrigan, Tom Clark, Joanne Kiger, and others, together with Lewis's poignant prose annotations written 25 years later, resulted in a very precise document of snapshot poetics, to borrow Allen Ginsberg's phrase. With the secret location on the Lower East Side book and exhibition at the New York Public Library have developed without our chance meeting in Park Slope? I don't think so, because it was the subsequent acquisition of Lewis's papers by Rodney Phillips for the Berg Collection that was a seminal moment in the process. Also, the idea for the Angel Hair anthology was a lark one Sunday afternoon while we were driving around back roads upstate New York. From our daydream, Lewis and Anne created, in the words of Jerome Rothenberg, an archival masterpiece. I'm very grateful to have known and worked together with this lovely man, a wonderful poet, writer, editor, publisher, artist, and archivist. He was a friend of mine. I love you, Lewis. Thank you all.
For Lewis, shall we begin? Yes. And so he always ended his questions that yes. Whatever it might be, current events, politics, war, genocide, about our work. And so began the talk. The explanation, the exploration, the searching, the beginning of 2 hours on those Saturday afternoons at Bee's Place, no, Bellerose Salon on Park Avenue South. Bee's gone now too, a magical woman with a magical place. Large windows with glass beads from top to bottom, that crystallized into notes if the windows were cracked open, if we brushed up against them accidentally. 2 hours of magic, even if I didn't believe in magic. But I learned so much in those hours, learned to love the poetry, my fellow poets, those we studied, those I studied with. We were 6, 8, usually, yes, or more. B, Ruth, Lilla, Phyllis, KB, Peter, Dennis, Michelle, Donna, Valerie, Karen. Who am I leaving out? One Saturday, the question, do you consider yourself an intellectual? Yes. No, I thought. I come from the working class, though I'd hardly done any work to be part of that class that really works. Not like my father tolling in cane fields, in cafeteria fields on Delancey, washing pots and pans, short order cooking in Jewish delis, or Mammy working in the Dixie Cup factory, making Dixie Cups. So I wasn't an intellectual. How could I be if I'd not come from the class of the intellects? You have to come from a class, no? And stick to it, no? Lewis that day went around the circle at B's and asked each one, are you an intellectual? Yes. Or no? And why so? Yes. Lewis went around the group always so expertly, drawing each one out, so interested in whatever we gave, what we had to say. He always called us poets. What we said should be heard, yes? We'd met at his workshop at the project, and at the end of the 10 sessions, Phyllis went around and asked if any of us had any interest in continuing to study with Lewis. And so our group was formed, and so we met at B's. We paid Lewis $3 apiece. After a while, did it go up to $5? Maybe $8? Yes. So little for so much. So much kindness, so much love, so much learning. Lewis never asked for a raise. It was one of us who made the suggestion, knowing how little we paid, how much he, Lewis, gave. And so I found out, after weeks and months thinking about Lewis's question, yes, I was an intellectual, and yes, I was a poet. I dedicated my second book, Whose Place, to Mami y Papi, who started it all. And yes, of course, to Lewis Warsh.
Lucky, lucky, lucky to know Lewis, yes. A lot of people have mentioned how Lewis had a real love for human nature, the lovely parts, the thorny parts, and he just embraced it all. So I'm going to read a poem from the first book that turned me on to Lewis, Information from the Surface of Venus. And it's about post a party, and it's called Walking Through Air. The door is still open, but the guests have gone, like shooting stars into the misty evening. And yet our thoughts of them linger on, and the memories they take from being with us, every blemish frozen on a graph. Words someone said, someone meant to say, something forgotten, words left hanging in the air that went by too quickly for a response to rise like smoke and register on the mind. Made memorable by nothing that was ever said, but what they thought about later in the end. At the end of their visit, footsteps echoing on the stairs. The clouds went with them like feelings across the sky, and the heaven that was suddenly filled with stars reminded us that light had fallen while they were here. Darkened windows, the lights of cars in the street, for whatever they are now thinking, they're remembering us too, as if this visit was something they dreamt and later revised, for accuracy's sake, to be invisible in our eyes. Take into account how they secretly conspired to say the opposite of what they meant, for what you forgot to tell them remains a mystery. The brevity of the visit was no surprise. And that sum of what made them wise, like a telegram to a person you love, that was never sent, spark the only feelings they know how to convey. And what could we say but, how are you doing? Bow down to your feelings as they come and go, like friends through a door and into the night, like strangers who never entertained the thought of arriving and to whom we said nothing, but hoped they enjoyed their trip through time, as if they'd known us in another time. This is what we knew they were thinking. So everyone departed at the same time, leaving us to clean up as an afterthought in slow motion, assemble dishes on a tray, and carry them to the kitchen. Our thoughts of them are with us now in separate diaries. We describe their visit, and later tonight, lying in bed, we'll compare notes as thoughts about what was meant by the words that were better left unspoken, laughter, tears, our voices filled the air, an old emotion, commonplace sentiment everywhere.
You know, it took me until 2 minutes ago to understand why the mic was being changed between speakers. I thought, duh, sanitation. To have known someone since the age of 21 or 22, it makes me laugh. Lewis often, in the late 60s and 70s, much of the 70s, was not living in New York. We saw each other fairly regularly, though. And we always talk real serious talk. But 10 and a half years ago, I retired, and he and I began a program, and it got to be more and more regular, of meeting for lunch on 7th Avenue. And now we were not thinking about a long future ahead of us. We talked old stories, old gossip, and as in the words of the song, we spoke of our lives and our dreams and how things come apart at the seams. I see in Lewis's writing the use of literal language as having a mystical code to it, which is in friction with the erotic ego slash id being a form of mysticism with its own code. And that is often, to me, the axis around which his poems work. I'm going to read two fairly brief parts. These are a series of numbered poems, and the book is Private Agenda, with a cover and internal art that is really stunning by Pamela Lawton, who you heard from earlier. It was published in 1996. This is section 4. No reason to repeat what you missed the first time, self-critically, as if someone were watching over your shoulder. Shadows loom up, are they objects or people? You treated her like an object, a thing, and she left the room. Where are the guidelines? Name objects and people in order of importance to your life. The piece of onion skin paper with her handwriting no longer readable. I wrote the word humanism in my notebook and crossed it out. That person, nameless, with whom your life and body is intertwined, the self-critical shadows that loom like clouds on every corner, the writing on the wall smudged, blotted, forever crossed out. Here is the interchangeable, yet rare, light, no detritus, of yet another day, inviting anger repressed and love unrequited to rise from behind the drapery and assume their prominent stage center. Here, rereading the unreadable as if it were a scar, a guide into and out of the mirror, with its critical frame, a trace of vanity pressed down over your tired eyes. 5. You have to give up something to get something in return. Sometimes it isn't even anything you want. You accrue some distance, but it's no longer necessary. You gave up what you valued most, and nothing came back. A single earring, a valentine. No valentine this year. The most you can hope for are some leftovers, someone else's possessions, on loan. You have to pay interest. I forget how much, but it's less than credit card interest. You don't have to pay by the month and no one bills you, but the interest accrues. And now you have something you don't even want. It's something you thought you wanted, but when you have it, it isn't real. Having something isn't real.
I have no idea why Lewis asked me to write a blurb for Inseparable. I have no idea why he asked me if he could publish a book of mine. I don't think he actually gave it very much thought. I think it was like, he felt like it. It wasn't strategic. I miss talking with him. I have a lot I would want to talk to him about. But I'm going to read some poems from Alien Abduction. If I can find my note about which ones. Okay. There we go. Nocturne. It's possible you can see someone from a distance after all these years and stop in your tracks or do a double take and wonder if maybe it's just someone who looks like someone you used to know, or if it's the real person, and then you walk on by, like in the song, walk on by, and then you turn again, but the person's gone and all you can do is haul yourself up to the roof and jump off or shoot yourself in the foot so that you can't walk, can't move, and time hangs heavy as you sit in your room and wonder if that person was him or you or someone's twin who arrived from another planet to savor the lilac scent that radiates from your skin. And the heat comes up from the pipes like Les Trois Gymnopédies by Eric Satie, and I turn the key without biting my tongue, and the heart comes back on until it bleeds, and I take back with one hand what I gave with the other, and someone comes in off the street, no longer invisible, and the kissing booth closes for the night, too bad for you, and I display my dish rag abs to the wind one last time, feel my skin on fire as I descend. One foot out the door. Maybe life can be defined by the things you didn't do. The days of amnesty, a pinup on the door of the locker, the combination safe and all the pleasure that comes from staying indoors when the sun is shining. At its apex, you might say, describing nothing. For once in your life, you're at a loss for words. There's a new library named after yours truly, at the dark end of the street, located between the dump and the cemetery, just so you know. Poem. You can fire the fusillades over my head for all I care, and cut my body in half on an empty stage. My name used to be Boxcar Bertha, but now I am one with the scum of the earth. You can carry me away from the uprising with my head bloodied and my arm in a sling. But if they ask you, they, meaning the people who report such things to the denizens of the deep, say I was smiling through closed eyes, though I couldn't speak, and the blood on my cheek was the color of pomegranate. Difference. There's a difference between being with someone and being alone, but I can't tell you what it is. There are things I do when I'm alone that I don't do around other people, but don't ask me what they are. For instance, I might have a bone to pick with you over something that happened long ago, but you wouldn't know it by the things I say or do, or the way I swivel my hips in time to the music, an old disco record hidden away in someone's attic. It seems like a short time has passed since we woke to the sound of garbage trucks in the street and yawned, grateful to be alive, but not really. I can fell this tree with a single blow of my axe, so stand back. Splinters of wood float down from the sky and alight on your skin. The roof of my mouth is parched, but we must ration the water if we expect to get out of here in one piece. There are still some things I want to do in this life, but don't ask me what they are. Prague, Berlin, Vilnius, Odessa, some cities I want to visit. Drive up the coast, Bolinas to Point Reyes. Walk the Malecón in La Paz one last time. Thank you, Lewis. Till next time.
Lewis has a wonderful poem called The Last Cigarette from Inseparable. There isn't time to read all of it, but here are the last few sections. This is just the beginning of someone else's story. If we make a mistake the first time, we can try again. If we lose our balance, we might fall to the bottom. Being in denial is just another form of stupidity. The doctor who was on duty wrote me a prescription for painkillers. I offer my guests a plate of bow tie cookies. It occurs to me that my audience consists of no one but you. Come, let us make a human being in our own image. You can see it in a new light now that it's already happened. If your mother calls, I'll tell her you're still asleep. We all have two points of reference, maternal, paternal. But distance is everything. A name you can't remember. Wait on eyelids of first spring rain. Moth wings flattened against a bulb. A pitchfork leaning against the side of a barn. Colored ribbons, fuselage, the map of intransigence. Islands off the coast of Alaska where we can go for a holiday. A voice on the intercom, is there a doctor in the house? All transitions are seamless, and this is true of the body as well. It requires you to put one foot in front of another, and when everyone stops moving, you continue, you go on. We have another plan, and it isn't Plan B. Fish dart out of crevices when they see you coming. There are stones embedded in the surface of the reef. This is the park where I played after school as a child. And this is the room where I lost my virginity. and this is where the banks of the river overflow.
Hello, everybody. I'm Jamie Jones, and in 2008, I joined Lewis's MFA program at Long Island University. I came from where I live in Florida and jumped into the New York pool, into the New York scene. And Lewis, from day one, so had my back, you know. Working with Lewis was an amazing thing, and as many people in this room can testify to. I referred to the program yesterday. I said something about the MFA program to someone, and I thought, you know, yeah, he was proud of that, and that was great, but that almost makes it sound like a small experience, because it was so much more than just a MFA program. It was spending time with this brilliant, generous, kind man who, you know, included me, and I'm not an exception, there's many people in the room here who he did this for, but included me in anything that was happening, any art opening, any reading, any party, made sure I met people, and it was really, really significant. His feedback was amazing. I wasn't always receptive to it. Jamie, you know that poem ended about three lines back. And it would take me a while to admit that he was right, but he was usually right. It did end three lines back. But it was just really spending time with him, talking in his office, going for walks with him, meeting him, going to book sales with him. It was really quite amazing. Not long after I graduated, my first book came out, called Blue Rain Morning, and Lewis immediately organized this event, a reading at Long Island University. So I came back, and that was just terrific. It was packed, and it was all my old friends and some new ones, and the room was just packed. And he was very proud, as was Barbara Henning, and they were both there. Barbara was my thesis advisor, and that thesis did become that book. And I'll never forget that. I'll be so grateful forever that he did that. Jump ahead to 2017, I was able to get Lewis and Barbara to Pensacola, Florida, which I think for Lewis was like going to a strange and alien planet, you know what I mean? Which it is like a strange and alien planet, truth be told. But they were so well received. They each gave a reading, they each gave a workshop, and it was like a four-day event. It was a lot of work. And then the final day, I moderated a discussion between them, and it was terrific. The turnout was great. They sold a lot of books. And the image that comes from that, there are a couple of things. When I introduced Lewis to read, the mic had been working fine, but as soon as he got up there, the mic didn't work. And he got very flustered, and I was trying to fix it, and he got impatient, and he just jumped away, and he came out in front of the crowd, and he just projected really well, and just gave this amazing reading that everybody was into. And he would just drop one sheet. He would finish a poem and drop the sheet because he had no podium. He walked away from the podium. That was terrific. And then the other thing that stands out about that is how much time and how much he listened to people that were buying his books, a lot of them my students who were coming up to him and wanting to talk to him. He took time with everybody, and it was so beautiful. And then you know, I had one student who was hanging out at the book table, looking at them. He really didn't make a decision. There were about 10 of Lewis's books there. And I later told Lewis, I said, yeah, he doesn't have the money to buy that, Lewis. And as soon as Lewis found out that he really couldn't afford a book, he grabbed three or four of them and went and found the student and gave him the books and talked to him about it. It was really a beautiful thing. Also, when they were there, we were able to, I belonged to a group of artists called Art Beyond Walls, and we were able to wheat paste Lewis's portrait and Barbara Henning's portrait on this trestle, this train trestle, called, known as the Graffiti Bridge, where graffiti artists hit it every day. And we also covered it in their faces in a lot of Lewis and Barbara's lines and pieces of Lewis's collage all over this train track. It was really quite spectacular. Lewis never saw that until, like, about 4 days later, when it was completely covered. Barbara's was completely covered up. What remained of Lewis was his name. Now, this picture, I think, was up here, so it's been used a few times. But I was taking him to the airport, and we pulled up, we drove by this bridge so he could see it when we got out, and I said, Lewis, you have to stand there. Stand there, let me take this picture. And I don't know, it was just quite this amazing moment, you know. And I'll be forever grateful that we did that. I was grateful that I could pay them, too, you know. I mean, we need to get paid. And I was able to do that, so that was really terrific. I guess the main thing, you know, that I learned from Lewis and is that, you know, being a poet is full time, you know. And for him, it was inseparable from being a teacher. It was inseparable from being a friend. It was part of his life, and that was a valuable lesson for me. I wrote this poem last year, and I'm going to end with this. It's called Guppy Doors. Guppy is a funny word, but for whatever reason, I don't think I ever saw that until you used it once or twice in the stanza of a poem you were working on. This was in a dream I recently had. I didn't see it on the page, but listened as you read it aloud to me and Barbara. You were not trying to point out the clown-like quality of Guppy. In fact, you read it in a kind of serious tone, which actually was the best way to do this, show how funny the word is. This was not your intention, but it happened anyway, and Barbara and I both laughed at the same time, which took you by surprise. You seemed to not understand, looking at us in a slightly indignant, but more like bemused way, puzzled, which made us laugh more, though we were almost trying not to, but couldn't help it. The guppy doors were fully opened, and you shook your head at us a little, as if to ask, what's so funny? And your bafflement eased into a slight but genuine smile. Thank you. Thank you, Kat, Sophie, Marie, and Max.
Lisa Rogel, who's part of our, is this thing on?
That's Lisa.
She's Lisa's here on the phone since she has COVID and couldn't come. Yeah. So that's her participation in our tribute to Lewis. There's everybody. There's Lisa. Hello.
Hi. Hi, everyone.
Yeah. So the four of us were all students of Lewis's at Long Island University in the MFA program some years ago. And as such, we wanted for our contribution of a tribute to this remembering of Lewis, the celebration of Lewis, to kind of talk a little bit about his pedagogy and Lewis as a teacher, right? To bring in that perspective, to share a little bit of the sense of the playfulness and the wonder and curiosity that Lewis brought to his teaching. So Lewis's, in teaching at LIU, in our experience, the playful and the serious were never opposed. They're always kind of happening at the same time. And there was such an emphasis on opening different ways of thinking, opening different ways of relating to the spaces you're in and the people you're around, and your own position with yourself and others and how that's all working as a way of approaching writing poems and as a way of being a person in community and in the world with other people. And so in light of that, we wanted to kind of just play a game or share a lesson that we learned from Lewis.
Now, we could argue semantics, but...
Right, a game or an assignment, so please. This is...
You, tree or shoe?
Tree or shoe?
Tree.
Tree?
Tree.
Tree. Okay. Why tree?
Hmm.
Because I like what?
I don't know.
I don't know either.
So, do you get identification with the trees?
Mm. Jamie? Tree or shoe?
Shoe.
How about this? On three, we all say tree or shoe.
Your response
yes.
to the question.
Right? One, two, three. Shoe.
Lisa, what do we think?
I say tree.
Tree.
Shoe.
Interesting.
You want to go?
So call it a game or an exercise or, you know, whatever you wanted. It was really fun to go around the room and hear everyone's reasoning, tree or shoe. And, you know, I think that's, Lewis was just interested in, like, the workings of the mind and why one would pick tree or shoe. And, you know, Lewis's office was a sort of hub for all of us as students. You know, we could sit there for hours. And, you know, my big thing was that I could say anything to him. You know, I'm an oversharer, but I never felt like I was oversharing with Lewis. In fact, he encouraged me to say even more and to tell him about everybody else's business, which I really, I think both of us really enjoyed. So, yeah, he was just very interested in people.
Yeah, and tree or shoe really helped me get beyond this kind of maybe fetishization or something of poetry. I don't know, this kind of like, I was in his class, of course, and or he would just start talking about Coca-Cola or something else. and I would think to myself, what the hell does this have to do with poetry, you know? And in a very frustrated way at first, but then, you know, once you let yourself, you know, get carried along with the logic or not logic, I think, the not logic is actually more important for Lewis in that moment, then you really do sort of learn something about being present, I think, in a way that breaks with these kinds of logics and expectations that we have. I don't know. It was very helpful to my poetic practice because I could really then think of a poem in two worlds, kind of as separate from this world, but also as something that is necessarily clashing with it all the time or something, you know?
The tree world so, and the shoe world.
Yeah, the tree world, exactly. Yeah, so you have to choose.
Lisa?
Is it my turn? Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah. I'm sort of, I can't quite hear everything, so if I repeat something, I'm sorry. What I wanted to say is that I think his teaching was a very gentle, open invitation to play and to experiment and to see what happens. And I felt like Lewis was always sort of inviting into things, into friendship, community, and into that kind of curious way he had about that attitude of what might happen if you did this. And I think he even wrote that quite a bit on poems of mine, like, what if you did this? What if you said this or took this out? And it was always a suggestion and an invitation. And it taught me something quite a bit, actually, about poetry and about how to be a poet in the world and how to be a person in the world. Maybe they are the same thing. Maybe we're all people. But yeah, I really admired him, and I'm going to miss him a lot.
All right.
Thank you.
Hello, everyone. It's very interesting to hear all the
Long Island University students. I think I was in one of Lewis's very first workshops back in 1974 and 1975 in this very place. So a lot of the things that he was doing with them, he started with a group of poets here that included me, Robin Messing, Bill Kushner, Guy Gauthier, Maggie Dupree, and Richard Edson, and several others. So we got the early Lewis. Okay. So this is what I basically sent to the Poetry Project for his tribute page. But before I say this, I gotta say two things. One, since I told Vincent Katz I would say this if nobody else mentioned it, but you know what? Lewis kept his hair. He had fabulous hair in the 70s. Fabulous hair. And anyway, and the other thing I'm going to say, and because I've lived in New York long enough and I know what the actual meaning of this is that Lewis, at least in my life, was a mensch. He was a very good man, and he was very good to me, and I am incredibly grateful for that. So anyway, here's my little essay. In an essay entitled The Summer of 1975, I look back at the first year at the Poetry Project and the workshops I took and why I found myself in the one led by Lewis Warsh. And I'm quoting from myself. He had a way of focusing on a word, phrase, or line and sort of teasing out what should or should not be there. This could be blunt or very subtle. I don't remember him ever saying something was crap. I did hear that in other workshops, but the weaker writers slowly left the workshop, leaving a band of very smart, imaginative people in their wake. Lewis looked at my lyrics and, well, the adolescence in my writing departed. In a way, what was happening in the workshop was what was happening to me. I would bring in these long, shifting pieces. Lewis would look at them and say, what's really going on? And then I would have to see what was really going on. When I look at that description, I realize that Lewis's greatest asset was his generosity. He was generous with knowledge, generous of spirit, generous with praise, generous with encouragement. Maybe that's why he was so skinny. I don't know. I just know that he had a way of finding the poem, the person, the tune and tone of the moment. He could be sharp if something did not work. He'd let you know. But that sting was never hurtful. I think he worked very hard to not be cruel. I think he worked very hard to express love and friendship. I think he worked hard to honor his ideas of poetry, poets, the writing life. Sometimes he was rewarded for this, often, much too often, overlooked. This is a little memory. I sublet Lewis's apartment when he went away for a few weeks in the summer of 1975. There were many books and objects and fabrics. He had a Russian girlfriend, an opera diva. He always had these weird girlfriends. Anyway. And fabrics. He had a Russian girlfriend, an opera diva. She was really quite amazing. Okay. It was very lush and piles of pillows and cheap furniture. It was oh so bohemian. And yes, in all that clutter, you knew that this was the home, even if temporary, of a poet. Words and books, the textures of rugs, cushions, pillows, the hard back of cheap chairs. Was the floor painted? I don't remember. But all those things that surrounded him mattered. made their way into his poems and stories and teaching. Lewis could seem somewhat dour and distracted, but oddly, I think of him as having a very droll sense of humor. He could arch those considerable brows when needed. He gave me some of the tools I needed to become a really strong poet. He gave those tools to a whole lot of people. And he did that for so many others because in so many different ways, he knew what was really going on. I miss him dearly.
Speak. I met Lewis, I think, I can't remember the exact year, either in 70 or 71, but I know where it was, between 7th Street, where I was living, and right here. I never went north of 12th Street. Then I moved to London, I had, in 72, and I had three or four of his books with me. And they traveled with me to Algeria in the middle 70s. Then they traveled with me to Paris. And whenever I looked in them, I wondered, why did I bother leaving this place? He said it so well. I would like to live there where Lewis is writing and doing all these things. We came back and we were extremely lucky. In 2000, we were living in Albany. I was teaching at university and Lewis came to teach for a semester and he was our house guest. So those were amazing nights of poetry, food, talk, poetry, food, talk, drink, drink, food, poetry, talk, all night long. Let's celebrate Lewis by sharing the food he has cooked up in his poems. The specialty of the house was not a menu.
But you could request it from the waiter.
The waitress or the maitre d' who'd bow down and kiss your knees.
Out of a desire to give pleasure.
I'd go to the store.
To buy some scallions.
I want to go to a restaurant.
Where the waiters call me comrade.
Won't order any new food in restaurant.
For fear I won't like it.
Order only what I like.
Another ruined evening.
The guy pointing the gun at the side
of my neck was sucking on a lollipop.
The restaurant turned me away.
Because I was wearing a jacket and a tie. I wasn't wearing a jacket and a tie.
The fish aren't large enough to eat.
So you throw them back in.
In a fairy tale, a wedge of cheese
fall from his beak into a puddle.
You go out for a container of milk.
And slam the door behind you.
You curse under your breath.
And you take out the garbage.
An empty bottle of soy sauce.
Alongside a can of warm beer.
It's still dark out.
When I drink my first cup of coffee.
You can't have everything.
Or they say so.
So I settled for a kettle prod and a bowl of prunes.
I kept the salt on top of the icebox.
Along with honey and a bottle of cognac.
Lunch is served.
Soup with kumquats.
Mixed seafood grill with bouillabaisse sauce.
Root ravioli and chocolate chip cookies.
I left the muffin in the toaster.
And the smoke alarm went off.
The father buys his son
a bar of chocolate for the ride home.
There used to be restaurants around here
where you could sit for hours
over a cup of coffee.
What I like to do is call up all my friends.
People I haven't seen in years reserve a booth in
an expensive restaurant and order the most expensive
items on the menu, flirt with the waitress and not
eat anything.
It's pleasurable to eat.
The same thing for breakfast every day.
A single drop of rain explodes on the windshield.
My father drinks coffee from a red thermos.
To stay awake.
I cut the food into tiny pieces.
And arranged them on my father's plate.
For breakfast, eat two
days-old donuts, and you don't
be hungry until dinner.
Biting the hand that feeds you
turns out to be no fun.
Some mornings, cold soup
makes a natural environment.
The food in the icebox
The books on my shelf.
It's winter.
The grasshopper is begging.
The ant for food.
It seems like each dinner
consists of leftovers.
From the night before.
Something I ate last night
made me feel sick this morning.
The Chinese waiter handed me a
plate of sliced oranges.
Tantalus serves the body
of his son Pelops to the gods.
It's rare to find someone who
is willing to share food with you.
The words means much, much, much more than you say.
A meal ticket
to instant happiness. Nepheas, for Louis. The sun has set too fast today. Can a water lily show us the way? Like a painting by Claude Monet. Let Giverny bridge memory. Wet paint onto wet paint emphasizes your quality. The perception of your movements belongs to les effets du soir. Your poetry a guide, your kindness a guide, your thoughtfulness a guide, your smile a guide, your eyes a guide, your love a guide, your light a guide, your light our guide. Keep sending light. Please, Louis.
We need it.
Let your long locks fall from your fair face like some tender shroud. Brush them away so I can see who you really are. Smarten up, you were always smart. Make yourself ready, you were always ready and attentive and kind. And the great rememberer, intimate memoirist, storyteller, witness, yes, this all happened. Your grace. Now we remember you, Louis. I was thinking aloud, but no one heard. My words were the songs of birds on a summer morning outside a deserted shack in the middle of nowhere. Even the air vibrated in horror like a car alarm after midnight rattles the silence of some sleepy town. I thought of Fra Angelico and the Dominican friars scraping paint on the walls of Santa Marco in Florence, poring over their tomes in their tiny cells. And for a moment, I wanted to be like them, enclosed in my own aura, like a cobra shedding its skin. All the world has to offer, I've already rejected. Self-conscious to the core, I dismantled what remains of my being in midstream and built out of nothing a universe for my eyes only. Once I was a jealous husband walking down Avenue B, and once I boarded a plane and flew to Athens, and once I hitchhiked on the back of a motorcycle over a mountain on Christmas Eve, and once I coughed and woke you up in my sleep. I want to steal away into the darkness where no one else has gone. The cold sun harbors loss at the foot of my chair. A man with a cue card appears in the wings and everyone weeps. It occurs to me that my audience consists of no one but you. I met Lewis here in 1977, and I love him forever.
Hello, everyone. I would like to thank Kat for inviting me to be a part of this. Lewis is a part of my life. He's been since I arrived in New York City in 2007. In fact, he was introduced to me by Stacy Shamishek, the former director of the Poetry Project, just in that room. And right from that day, Lewis was on my case. As a teacher, as a mentor, as a provocateur, I've had lots of you talk about how easy he was and all that, but I found him enigmatic. He was an enigmatic person. I remember asking him once about his book, The Marahaja's Son, and he looked at me straight in the eyes and said, "I didn't write a word of that book." So there are lots of paths to Lewis, but meanwhile, I would like to read from a book of his titled The Origin of the Sun, which came out in 2001. I think it was his first book that he autographed for me. "I went to pick berries on the road to oblivion. They call themselves communists, but all they want are dishwashers and big cars. A light without shadow generates an emotion without reserve. Members of the staff leave the institution after an 8-hour shift, but the inmates stay forever. He can ask someone for money without losing his self-respect. My mother didn't know what I wanted for my birthday, so she gave me some money. I put my money on awe-inspiring, but it came in last. Border violations between genres were reported by the authorities. Type poems on stencils, run them off on the Mimeo machine, call up friends to help collate and staple, mail copies into the world. I have some knowledge of her, but maybe I am thinking of someone else. I think of what I will say, what I could possibly say if we ever met. The place becomes the words you use to describe it, but your feelings about the place have a life of their own. At Paris, we went to the bedroom where the guests stashed their coats, locked the door, swept the coats onto the floor, and took off our clothes. I changed my religion to please her parents, but they still hated me. New words are needed to heal the rift. We avoid each other in the bookstore. We pretend we don't see each other. I think you could most feel guilty for not answering my last letter. You don't realize how much I love you. Your last book was great. There is a beach hall for yourself with a sign that reads, "No trespassing, tacked to a tree." How fortunate we are to be separate from the sea at last. Mansions where executives once lived with their families will be split into apartments for the families of the workers. The cab driver orders me out of his vehicle. I owe him 17 cents. I postpone pleasure so I can enjoy it more later. Boredom of expectancy when no one comes. We go to her house and sit on the living room sofa while her parents sleep inside. Example, maybe tonight she will let me put my hand inside her blouse. The desire for objectivity harbors the intrusion of jealousy. It seems like you might never stop loving her, and then you do. There's the movie theater where I saw Rocco and his brothers, dubbed version. There's the schoolyard where I played asses up. In the fairy tale, a wedge of cheese falls from his beak into a puddle. We can't tell the players on the scorecards without sleeping with them. Last year at this time, or 10 years ago, or 20, a quarter century passes by as if it were a quarter hour or a minute. When I was 9, I hit a girl on the shoulder with a stone to get her attention. This house will never be empty of the torment of loving. No sweat, one might say, as the solution to any pain. You light a thin cigarette and then put it after taking it off, one puff. You got out for a container of milk and slam the door behind you. You curse under your breath as you take out the garbage. The story of old tells of love as well, but in a different light. I was standing on a platform in the 14th Street subway station when a guy pointed a gun at me, and another guy pressed a gun against the side of my head and said to my girlfriend, "What's a chick like you doing with this faggot?" The people in the cars wave at me as I walk across the bridge. I see myself crossing the bridge. I'm going back the way I came. It's too late for me, but maybe you can learn from my experience. She knew I was coming home someday, but she didn't know exactly when. There was a chain on the door, but she didn't hear me when I called her name. You can't call him a bachelor or a sadist and expect me to know what he is like. The blue of the gitans park on the table in the stranger's apartment. Back in the village, in the presence of their weeping sisters, the Marines were humiliated by their instructors. I look up words in the thesaurus to make my poem sound more interesting. He was fired on Tuesday without notice, and we never saw him again. Saw an apartment on 13th Street between 1st and A, three small rooms for $800, but didn't take it. Thank you.
It's a real honor to be here celebrating with everyone here, as it was an honor to be part of bringing a couple of his books into the world. I was a huge fan of Lewis's first, of his work, and then I became very fond of him as a person through working with him on these books and through seeing him when I would go out more in New York to poetry things. And I don't think I realized until after he was gone how much I had quietly come to count on him
I really trusted his way of moving through the world for all the reasons everyone's said here. So, like everyone else, I miss him a lot. Last judgment. You might think the last judgment is already at hand. Even if you make your escape, there's nowhere to go. She interrupted me as soon as I started talking. My credit card is invalid. My arm is in a sling. The landscape rolls by, even when you're sleeping. I wouldn't call if it wasn't an emergency. You can go into the corner and sulk like a baby. Go back to the beginning and repeat everything you said. A patch of snow at the base of a tree, the smell of persimmon. Come to bed before it gets too late and the sun rises for the last time. Place the shore in its proper relation to the birds in the sky. You can learn the foxtrot in three easy lessons. Wiped my boots on the welcome mat and sold my soul to the company store. Late afternoon muscle tone, a backyard fizzle. A coin falls through a slot and lands in the dust. There used to be a nail salon around here. There used to be a car rental agency. I lounge about hawking my credentials through a filter. I'll call you when I'm in town, but I don't know where you are. The curvature of the spine is no longer incurable. I'd take you up on your offer, but I'm hard of hearing. Turn up the volume if you want to hear the birds. A suspicious van was discovered on a street near Times Square. Keep your mouth shut and nothing will happen to you and your friends. Do I run on ahead of myself or do I bend with every thought? I take off my socks and put my head under the fire hydrant. All hell breaks loose when you close your eyes. I can take home what you can't eat and feed it to my dog. The door opens and woof woof, the air disappears. A woman with a toothpick at the company picnic catches your eye. Wore out my welcome and disappeared up the chimney like Scrooge. The knives and forks take on a life of their own, but all the spoons are bent out of shape. It's possible to disappear into thin air like a kiss. The conductor shouts, "All aboard," but I'm asleep on my feet. A flock of paralegals sing the 1812 overture before dawn. Call for backup, one might say, as the clouds pass in front of the sun. You might fall asleep in the snow and never awaken. Maybe we met by accident or were introduced by someone we knew. The lesser of two evils shows up on my doorstep with a warrant. Quiet intervals, synthetic drapes, a reflection in still water. I confuse two people on a bed in my head. I arrive empty-handed, no suitcases, no referendums, no slugs.
You all look so great here in the gathered in the Church of Poetry to remember St. Louis, the Bronx, who did his own little miracles, you know, turning the everyday into those miracles, and then turning the miraculous into the everyday, you know, is nobody like him. Dear Communard, the satisfaction of human needs creates new needs, Marx said. Just as a poem gives birth to another almost immediately after you finished the one before, so there's no sense of completion and only an occasional word crossed out, deleted. No completion seems to be the order of the day. Something left out calls for its other. A warm bed is all one needs, and the new poem is calling, but the operator is asleep, and the words are lost and found again. That's the other theme. The ghosts of the past enter stage center. The animals and the street people line up on the boardwalk. The ocean looms. Scatterbrained birds of a feather fly south for the winter. The deletions add up. The Hotel de Ville burns to the ground. One wing of the Louvre is gone. A mural by Delacroix turns to ash. The poem needs some sustenance, but no one can give enough. That's what I was like when I was younger, insatiable in my own way. So the people thought me strange for wanting more than I had. But the mystery is in the words, never enough. I might have worn them on my sleeve. So what do you say we get down on our knees and pray for some God of forgiveness to man the barricades? Or do we take it as it is, as it goes, while remaining cognizant of what happened down through time, all the thens and theres mingling with all the I's and you's until a direct address is delivered to all of Paris on the day that 100,000 Prussians did a victory lap down Les Champs-Élysées. And it all really happened. Dear Communard, well, these are poems from Alien Abduction. This one is the New Testament. Sometimes only a loincloth covers the lower part of his body, but no one is telling him that nakedness is a sin or a lie. No one is lying to him or lying beside him in the dark, removing the loincloth or fig leaf from the lower half. There are dogs barking outside the sandwich bar, and a parrot is on display in the lobby of the Marriott, locked like a cage for everyone to see. In the cage for everyone to see. If I could see in the dark, I would tell you the difference between the animal and the vegetable, the nameless and the virginal. Those who rove the streets and estuaries, their limbs exposed to the elements, and those who stay at home behind gated windows and tinted glass. Polar night. Maybe if you could see yourself from a distance, you could see what people see when they see you close up. They can see the canaries and the penguins and the darts flying through air like missiles above a city. Only the trajectory is all wrong. Only the sonnet is wrong, and the signature on the dotted line, a pool of light in the puddle at the bottom of the well. Maybe if you abandoned the song and the tubes of the radio went dead, you would rub the hands of a stranger in the storm. You would lie on a mattress with broken springs and take your swings with your foot in a bucket. If you close your eyes tight, you might recognize me if I touch your skin. That tattoo of a flower in the shape of a heart.
Hi, this is Gloria Frim coming to you from Berkeley. Like Frank O'Hara, probably 100 people could claim that Lewis Warsh was their best friend. I love Lewis like a brother. We could tell one another anything, And we did the day we officially got together in person for the first time at a funky apartment he was renting alone in maybe 1999 in Greenpoint. We talked for what seemed like 8 hours nonstop. There was no place to sit and no furniture, so we sat on his bed or on the floor and told one another everything important about our lives so far that we didn't already know from our correspondence, which began in the days of his editing the journal, The World. It was the longest conversation I've ever had, and it continued for another 20 years through emails and phone calls and rare meetups at Naropa or in New York or Berkeley. Lewis and I seem to have the same sense of irony. I read once that this mutuality is important in a friendship. He displays it in his work, some of which is composed entirely of deadpan sentences. You can see the same strategy in many of his visual collages. I always found Lewis a deeply maternal man. He was interested in women. He was a man for women, a compassionate man who had many women friends and who helped a couple of great women launch their poetry lives. Though it's been since November 2020, I'm still incredulous that Lewis is gone. Borges says, when writers die, they become their books. But for so many of us, Lewis was also a chosen member of our family. Thank you.
Thank you so much for having me. Thanks, Kat, and family and friends. I just wanted to say that I think our society and culture is particularly ill-suited, perhaps now more than ever, to recognize the kind of genius and achievement of Lewis in particular. And I know that we will all do our best to make sure that his work lives and reaches more and more people that will benefit from it in the deepest possible ways. I ended up transcribing a poem from a reading at the Ear Inn, May 26, 1979, as I was thinking of what to do. It seemed a way of maybe communicating. To have an eye to. Imagine a kind of analysis. The dreams of youth are replaced by the dreams of maturity and middle age. Dreams more real now that half of life is past, and this is the content of life, these dreams. I know no other way of putting it. The dreams of youth are not forgotten. Like cardboard lovers, they attach the room to the side of a promontory. Marie's favorite book is Bawling Buddha, because there's a TV on the cover and the pages are different colors. A pagoda-shaped cloud hovers above the town like the real pagoda in the park opposite Albert Hall in London, which I walked by my last night in London, as if it were an omen that could alleviate all suffering and despair, a symbol of a dream in a red chamber filling the air that exploded, as I saw my dreams go up in smoke, singeing my hair, and in general, wreaking havoc on my body's person. This is where I live, in my body, in my mind, in my heart, where a little old lady bangs on the door to complain about the baby at 7 a.m. A blue and white postal truck stops at the corner. You see, I'm trying to draw on all my resources in an attempt to portray a feeling for who I am, draw on my feelings like a scanner picks out stars in the midnight sky and dispatches them immediately to a place on earth where everything is simple, serene, free of artifice and deceit, where everything remains to be learned and discovered anew by memory, by heart. Thank you.
Lewis and I corresponded for about Lewis and I corresponded for about 8 months before he died, quite regularly, and I want to read 3 letters that he wrote to me. This one is from September 25th, 2020. Dear Alice, I hope someone can be with you before and after the radiation treatments. Maybe during Christmas, if that's not too late. Traveling is complicated. Sophia is here,
but must go through a quarantine process, so hard to know when we will see each other, but we talk endlessly on the phone. She didn't get a return ticket because there's no problem getting a last-minute ticket, and she's made a deal with her job to stay as long as she wants. She's staying at Marie's while Marie stays with James, an old friend from Boulder, Ethie Stearns, someone you might know, also offered her a place on Perry Street. I'm sure I'll see her soon. It's hard to explain what you're going through to anyone else. When I first learned I had cancer, I didn't tell anyone except Kat and the kids. I hoped the cancer would go away, and it did, after surgery. But now that it's back, I don't care who knows. But I don't go into details with anyone except family, and there are more details beyond cancer that are too exhausting to put into words. The main question is that it's really happening to all our friends and now ourselves. The conversation I have with Kat is how much I can take before I call it quits. I had treatment on Tuesday and the days afterwards, like today, are the worst times. Everything tastes awful and it's hard to stay awake, but I'm used to how it happens by now. Next Tuesday I have break from treatment, a big protest march happening on 6th Avenue. No justice, no peace right now, with the helicopters overhead. The car trip across England with Ted was totally memorable, and now I remember walking with Sandy in Kew Gardens that summer as well, so thanks for reminding me she was part of this complicated picture. One high point of the trip was looking at Ted, who was driving, and I could see inside his brain, and I couldn't imagine, we had taken LSD, how he could be in so much control he could drive a car. His brain was like a very wound up ball of thread. I can see it now. I need to get better so I can write this story to Nick, or maybe I'll just pull it out of my memoir. I've been taking Ambien every night for 10 years, and then a half hour later, I top it off with a Percocet. One terrible side effect of this cancer treatment is something called peripheral neuropathy, which affects the tips of my toes and fingers. So right now, as I type, my fingers are getting cold. These are the details that are more than anyone wants to know, but they are totally part of my dailiness. I was more than pleased to see the Angel Hair catalog Steve put together. It made me happy that an accurate version of the poetry world still exists, apropos the world you describe in your letter, or the reviews of some terrible books I read yesterday in the New Yorker. I remember when Philip G. sent me the covers for Incidentals. I was sitting on a bench overlooking the Charles in Cambridge, Mass. Philip always treated me very generously, and I was overjoyed when the covers arrived. One of the memories I return to when I'm feeling down and out. I must take a break now and toast my hands in a heat pad, as they seem to be called. Too bad the world is going to explode on our birthdays. With much love, Lewis. I think this is October 20, no, this is October 24th. Dear Alice, I'm at home taking different meds. What they do is monitor and decide what meds make it feel more like being alive, no more infusions until I make the choices. My fingers are very cold, and that makes everything hard to do, not only writing letters. The nurses from home hospice are very nice. Everything is done at home and on the phone. Today I woke up trying to convince Kat I was William Shakespeare and that she should run away with me because I had changed my character. She was really Harris's first wife. Please keep in touch with me about your medical appointments and everything else. Kat's two sisters have been evacuated from Estes Park, Colorado, because of the fires. I spoke to Anne last night, and she is in dire straits as well. With love, Lewis. And this was the last letter on November 3rd after my operation. Here's the shortest of emails. With hope, it takes the shortest of paths to get to you and to send best wishes to you for the weekend. I wish I knew who I was in the days ahead, but some days it takes all the space between needles and the Bronx to figure it out. With love, Lewis.
Oh my God, that was amazing. Thank you, Alice. And And it was a great, great honor to be here. And thank you, Kat. And thank you, Ree and Sophie and Max, for putting this together. It's just been so incredible. And I also want to send greetings from the community in Boulder, from Naropa, where Lewis taught quite frequently over the summers and touched so many students, helped their work, stayed in contact, and so on. All the things we've heard, all the generosity, all the kindness, all the brilliance. I want to say his work was so important to me over many years, and I think these last kind of 20 years, the growth of his work, I mean, somehow the body of his work just got stronger and stronger. I loved his readings. We had never been really out of touch. I want to say his children are amazing. I mean, so conscientious and beautiful and brilliant and part of helping wake the world up to itself, which is what so many of you do. I want to thank Ed Bowes, who in a conversation about, you know, a couple of notes on this, just said, remember, we were so young with, you know, these blessings that we've had in terms of the early connections and friendships. And so many things when you're early in love and wanting to be a poet or being a poet, being an artist, being a member of something, and your first confession with someone, your first hesitation, the first poems you were showing and you want to please or argue or defend, or you're totally shattered, the first possessiveness, the first nightmares, the first dreams where that partner is, I don't know what was the dream, it was like in this room and he's in drag and what else is going on? He's also, you know, has a harem in the other room. And we're about to give some kind of reading and we're naked and we've taken LSD, whatever. But anyway, being poets together and rising into your fate, into your identity, into your world, and you're celebrating your first published book that maybe you've published yourselves. You know what it cost you to do that. You know the punch and the sweat and the joy. And you think of the beauty of collaboration and just living together, working together on the, working here, working on the magazines, et cetera. And then that sense of when you marry, you're marrying the world. Remember that? Her, the world, you're marrying the world. The first in-laws, so tender, and just any, I think Rose is in the room, just Lewis's family, I'd like to salute them. And the frames of all this, the being, you know, so involved with the infrastructure of things, the whole, you know, your whole body, your whole heart in it. And then the, you know, the consciousness, the loyalty of Lewis himself, and to, you know, the notion of liberty and our right to be who we are and make the work we make and live the way we desire to live with deliberation for what we love and care about. So a tribute to a slice of human time, of belletristic time, that it goes on. I love that Lewis also liked to go uptown. We'd dress up to go up to a Lita Hornick party, and we'd remember all the details. He was so good at remembering all the luminous details. So I feel like everybody here and so many others were part of the rhizome of Lewis Warsh, this amazing interconnected web of you know, shimmering light and insight and humor and gossip, high gossip, as Frank O'Hara would call it. Oh, I think it was Allen Ginsberg calling something that Frank did, high gossip, and more. So I love this family. I love the vibration of it all. And then thinking about, you know, the vows you take. In my case, that my big vow is the vow in Berkeley. We were together, and you know, you see that other person. What are the boundaries? What are the limits? Why is it so strange? And you know, I felt we could enter each other's worlds. He was also on the edge of being the best feminist in the world. It was a, you know, he was getting closer. He'll get there on the other side of all this. So I'm going to read this poem I wrote after he died, which is also Back to the Past. I'm glad so many of you filled in many of the other years, but I come back to that because what Ed and I were talking about, just how powerful that is when you start to find out who you can find out who you are together with somebody at some magical point in time. This is called Let Go. I said we started it. We founded it then, Angel Hair. That very night, the Robert Duncan reading in Berkeley, 1965. The conference, night we met. Robert Duncan commanded we make a magazine. You always said no later. It was later. It was the car ride. In a car, we founded it. How do you found something in a car? It showed the temper of our various minds. Talking in a car is a magazine, I suppose. I wanted it to be falling in love was also the idea. That night we were falling in love and we would be really good together, making something good together. You never just fall in love with a person and make love with them. That we make something, that's the whole point. That we are inside poetry and that Robert Duncan commanded this. I know he did, and he is a magus. And poetry was love for us. Poetry is so mysterious. How could he not have cast a spell, Robert Duncan? You were conversant in the most exciting poetry, Lewis, and the gossip about how Jack Spicer hated the Beats, and he wouldn't be part of the conference, and then he died. What think when they are falling in love, there is no future, we are right now. What I liked was being in this crowd of future, of poetry, want to make together another reality now. There would be babies with others, that's making time enough or no time for that. And a magazine is a paper window, also a car window. Keep opening the curtains. And maybe you need a windshield wiper and music and someone else driving to make a magazine, a bedroom of strange bedfellows. We were the next night somewhere on Knob Hill, a fancy part of town. You were so kind and very beautiful, your slender, gentle body. I'd never been there to San Francisco, but you had a story with the people in the apartment. Beautiful young men. I was a new tangle. I remember standing in front of a mirror on lysergic acid and going through all my lifetimes, and especially this one. I had a vision of all the persons I knew and how we had passed through sometimes, but it was important that we were all still together, changing how we looked, morphing, something radically changing us, fast changing us, and we were all feeling an urgency about knowing something together and doing something. And why were we all looking up? My vision was look up, all of it. The people I loved. I needed an assignment for them because of love. I thought, am I an egomaniac? If I could just get one assignment from up there, I could take it on so everyone could take that on for everything and everybody, and they also wanted to make something together. That was what I was supposed to make. Maybe it would work for everyone. What to do? And watch my face age and turn to dust. Poof. That was the point, that I disappear. It was a wandering day. Did I carry have that idea about a magazine from the day before? I can't remember, but I wanted it to be around words. And I remembered struggling to get over the bridge to hear Allen Ginsberg read for the conference. It felt important. It was important. And we were stopping and sitting down and lost in the lines on our hands and street lamp light and undulation, lines of undulation. I felt very light and so drawn to this fluid person next to me, and we were going to be poets together and make something. That was a feminine plan, a path through parks and other places, a wandering time, a femme plan, manicured parts, but action in a garden.
and plants and trees, very luscious, soft, and when they were not, they were reminders of plant intensity, vibrating, striking out, pushing you away. Then embrace these very animated plants, we then erotic. If you sat with them, you were with them, thinking with them, plants. I didn't know this city, San Francisco, at all, but it was many rays of light coming through a night and sitting by water. Where could that have been? Like velvet, sometimes a building, walking up hills, scent of jasmine, I am thinking, and we couldn't get over the bridge. And later I thought this was like karma, action. This was what you learn about action. Whether or not you get across a bridge to hear Allen Ginsberg for the first time is action. And when you don't, because you think it is important, you think you missed it, then it's karma. It will come back to haunt you. Were you meant to fall in love or go to a poetry reading? Fall in love? What we could do and did. What we didn't, couldn't do. And how far we could go. Let go. And may we continue to celebrate our wonderful members of this extraordinary time, an extraordinary world in a wild, wild, barbaric, beautiful, shimmering place.
Hi, everybody. I'm Marty Ehrlich. I know it's been a long afternoon. I'll be brief. First, I do want to thank very much to the family for asking me to be part of this. It's an honor. I probably knew Lewis the least of anybody who spoke today, but I knew him in such a special way, which was his tremendous kindness and appreciation of my wife, Erica Hunt. So that is how I knew him. I'm laughing a little. When I'm asked to play at a memorial or a funeral, there are two songs I have often leaned on, and I was planning to play them. But as we were driving in, I said to Erica, was Lewis Jewish? And it turns out he was. When the daughter talked about the Seder, but one thing I heard, by the way, today was the tremendous rich silences in Lewis's poems in between the lines. And I want to think about that a little bit. I'm going to play or put together a piece by the most poetic of composers, Ornette Coleman, entitled Broken Shadows, and a 200-year-old song that I learned from Frank London, but this was composed by the Alter Rebbe, who founded the Lubavitch movement. It's a song of praise, and it's called Eli Ato.
Thank you.
It's really wonderful to be here with you.
And to hear everything that's been read and said and played. Where's Marty? I've been thinking about those spaces and silences between lines in Lewis's poems for 25 years. I'm going to read two poems from this book, Elixir. It's a kind of genius to be able to figure out how to have a memorial and a book party at the same time. So I doubt Lewis planned it for that to happen, but I want to feel like like he did. He made that happen. But I know that Kat and Sophia and Max and Marie made that happen. I knew Lewis in weird ways throughout my life. I saw him naked when I was 5 years old. Then I was sort of didn't know how to talk to him when I moved back to New York. And then we became friends. Then we became colleagues. He invited me to teach at LIU. But I realized that at a certain point, he was teasable. It was mainly, I think, because I was listening to Sophia just tease him crazily about how bad of a driver he was, or something like that. Sorry if I'm getting that wrong. I'm going to read the title poem, Elixir, and then a poem called Old Flame. And Elixir's the longer poem, so I'm going to read it first, because I remember going to some readings he gave in the late 90s, and he would read longer poems early in the program, and I talked to him about it at one point. He's like, yeah, get it out of the way, so then everybody has no idea what's going to happen next. It's like, okay. Elixir. What matters most, my friends are gone. See their faces, hear them speak. I have so many regrets, he said. Ice cream, he wanted ice cream. The nurse brings me a cup of cold orange sherbet, the first thing I've eaten in days. Shklovsky's third factory analysis for the ride on my bedside table. I woke up thinking I was in my own bed. Shelley, the night nurse, brings me a pitcher of ice water. Everyone has a pathology. I was angry for a long time, and I didn't know why. In the middle of a fight, she put her hand through a French window. We had to take a taxi to the ER at St. Vincent's. It takes years to figure out who you are. When the surgery is over, you open your eyes. You must sign a consent form. You must sign your life away. Soon I will leave the hospital and walk down the street like any stranger. Once I arrived without asking at her house in the middle of the night, and she let me in. There's no one around to witness these moments. There's no one here except Shelley, the night nurse. The last time I was in the hospital, my roommate was Lee Konitz. He died soon after. I read it in the newspaper. I listened to him sing to himself in his sleep. My roommate was discharged earlier in the day, so I'm alone. Visiting hours 3 to 7, we'll talk on the phone. I see all the faces of my friends every day. I met Larry Fagan in the back of Gino and Carlo, a bar in San Francisco, 1963. I played chess and drank beer with Lee Harwood in my apartment in Cambridge. You can go home on Friday, the doctor says. No reason to stay here any longer. He called Kat after the surgery to assure her everything went well. Bill Corbett was the best man at my wedding in the country, 1975. You can begin a sentence with a capital letter and end with a period or not. Bill Berkson and I embraced one last time outside EJ's, May 2016. I told Ted Greenwald I would see him soon, and he said, you better come back tomorrow. The last time I saw Joanne Kiger was after her reading at Dia, Oh, Lewis. I ate lunch with Bill Kushner at Le Grand, and I knew something was wrong. I'm writing from Lenox Hill, my bed near the window. Soon the light will come up over the city. The night nurse, Shelley, will bring me a Percocet, maybe two. And no doubt Dr. Newman and his team will visit and the day nurses will arrive. Think of the most beautiful place, the anesthesiologist says as he puts me under. And my mind goes blank. Kat's face as I step from the shower and she dries my back and shoulders. My scrawny shoulders. Thursday, 4 a.m., June 11th, 2020. And this is Old Flame. There are movies that come back to haunt you at the end, and you can hear the music building to a crescendo like Hollywood. So you and the audience and you in the starring role are almost the same. Good looking, clean cut, uptight, all of the above and none. I wouldn't recognize you on a bus if you paid me to get on and off, and you wouldn't remember my name. For all the nights in the world, we crawled into bed with the lights on and the radio playing soft and low. We might as well have been blindsided by a 2-ton truck for all it matters, because there's only the present, like a movie played backwards with a cast of thousands hanging on for dear life.
So much everybody who came here today. I think this was exactly what Dad would have wanted. And I think he also would have wanted all of us to be happy and merry today. So let's go work on that in the parish hall where we have some refreshments. Thank you.
Thank you.